Since the Third Symphony is the longest Gustav Mahler ever wrote, I'm going to leave unsaid most of what I'd like to say about it, and I assure you that I could talk for hours about this one. But I'm going to let you research this one mostly for yourself, and will simply say this about it. It was composed during the years 1895 through 96, mostly during the summers of those years, and mostly in a small cabin that the composer had had built by the lake known as Atheist. Some revisions were made in 1899, and the first complete performance of the work was led by the composer in 1902. Mahler had originally supplied some descriptive, let's call them programmatic, titles for each of the six movements, and although he later withdrew those titles, it seems useful to me to know about them, as they might afford a kind of scaffolding for an understanding of the work. I have accordingly listed them, at least one version of them, for he changed his mind several times, at the beginnings of movements. Such scaffolding can always be dismantled when no longer needed. The orchestra Mahler calls for is as immense as the symphony itself. Four flutes, two doubling piccolo, four oboes, one doubling English horn, three clarinets, one doubling bass clarinet, two E-flat clarinets, four bassoons, one doubling contrabassoon, eight horns, four trumpets, posthorn, identified in the published score as flugelhorn, four trombones, bass and contrabass tuba, timpani, glockenspiel, snare drums, triangle, tambourine, bass drum with cymbal attached, suspended cymbals, tam-tam, birch brush, two harps, and an enormous body of orchestral strings, often richly divided. To the fourth movement, Mahler adds an alto soloist, and to the fifth, a children's choir, a women's choir, and the same alto soloist. The Mahler Third is considered the second of his three Wunderhorn symphonies on account of his use of songs he had composed on poetry from the folk anthology Des Knaben Wunderhorn. The scherzo movement is based largely on his Ablösung im Sommer, and the fifth movement on Es Zungen drei Engel. Mahler also drew on Nietzsche's Also Sprach Zarathustra for the fourth movement, during which an alto soloist sings Zarathustra's Rondelet. In this video, you'll be hearing a splendid recording by the Royal Concertgebouw Orchestra under the direction of Riccardo Chailly, with alto soloist Petra Lang, the women of the Prague Philharmonic Choir, and the Netherlands Children's Choir. This recording is available on the Decca label. Mahler indicated that this symphony, like the second, should be thought of as divided into two large parts. Part one consists of the first movement alone. This movement, oddly enough the last of the six to be composed, occupies almost a third of the symphony's entire length. It is absolutely gigantic. As in the corresponding movement of the second symphony, there are two expositions for a movement in sonata form. Also, as in the second, progressive tonality plays a role, although in the first of the two works, the progress from C minor to E flat major takes place over the entirety of the work, while here it is the opening movement itself that exhibits that feature, beginning in D minor and ending in F major. From its very first notes, played by eight horns in unison, we know we're in for something really unusual and special. And the remainder of this vast movement delivers on the opening's promise. Among its most notable features are a splendid trombone solo and one of the most unusual retransitions ever written. If you don't already know what that consists of, I'm not about to spoil it for you. Thank you.
Thank you.
2 of the symphony consists of the remaining 5 movements. Movement 2 is a sweet-sounding A major minuet whose contrasting trio is heard twice. In context, it affords a corrective to the challenging movement that preceded it.
Thank you.
The third movement is a somewhat biting scherzo, based largely on the Wunderhorn song Relief in Summer. Its single most memorable feature is its trio, a solo for offstage posthorn, with many of the posthorn's fanfares providing passable facsimiles of actual traditional Austrian posthorn calls. During the coda, there's a chilling reminiscence of the Second Symphony's Great Summons, and the movement ends with the greatest vehemence in high contrast to its delicate opening.
Thank you.
Since Mahler indicated that movements 4 through 6 should be played without intervening pauses, I'll talk about them as a group. You may recall that this feature was also true of the Second Symphony. Movement 4 is based on Zarathustra's Rondelet from Book 4 of Nietzsche's Also Sprach Zarathustra, with that famous song sung by an alto soloist. The symphony's cyclic quality here becomes evident, for some of this music was forecast in Movement 1. It seems to me that of all the Nietzsche settings I've heard, this is by far the finest, Richard Strauss notwithstanding. The dark Nietzsche movement is succeeded by one of the brightest sounding things Mahler ever composed, and is based on another of the composer's Wunderhorn songs, Three Angels Sang Sweetly. For this movement, Mahler again presses the human voice into service with a children's choir imitating the bim-bam of morning bells and a women's chorus singing the angel's song. The alto soloist from the previous movement puts in an appearance here also, and in response to her lament, Mahler includes some words of his own. The culmination of this massive symphony is its mostly serene adagio finale, which, although it does fall into crisis a couple of times, ends in full-hearted reconciliation and joy. No words I could add could possibly do it justice, so it's about time for me to step aside and let Mahler's music do the talking. I do want to add a final comment, however, by way of placing this symphony in the context not of the Austro-Germanic symphonic tradition, but of our own time, well over a century after it was first heard. I mentioned earlier that the work was mostly composed in a rather Spartan cabin with a lake view, fairly far from other human habitation. I've recently learned that although the cabin is still there, and often visited by music lovers who want a glimpse of the Third Symphony's provenance, is nowadays surrounded by a trailer park. That seems to me a somehow apt metaphor for what surrounds the Third Symphony in our own time, and that makes it almost impossible for most people even to get through a single hearing of it. I'll let you make of that what you will, and wrestle with it as you please. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.